Schoenfeld, Professor Emeritus, Political Science, UC Irvine.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Jack Peltason had a number of rare and treasured qualities, many of which will be remembered this afternoon. One of the most notable was his humility. In a world where pretentiousness frequently seems to be ubiquitous, Jack never took himself too seriously. One of his hallmark characteristics was self-deprecating humor. Today's event should reflect the type of person Jack was. Now, on your way here today, you surely crossed either Peltason East or Peltason West, the two axes that embrace the campus. Now, I should note that after the roads were named in his honor, he would tell you the roads should have been named for Susie. This was, on the one hand, a sign of his love for Susie, but also of his sense of humor. For you will recall that Susie's maiden name is Toll. I'd like to take this opportunity to introduce the Peltason family. First, Susie, who we all know and cherish, Jack's partner in love since 1946. Next, Jack and Susie's three children are with us today. Let me call them in birth order. Nancy. Tim. And the baby, Jill. Finally, there are a lot of other members of the Peltason clan with us today. The in-laws, grandchildren, etc. Could you all stand up, please? On behalf of the entire UCI community, we would like to thank you for allowing us to have this memorial today. Now, my first task is to introduce our chancellor, and as a way of doing this, I'd like to make two observations. First, Howard Gilman and Jack Peltason are both the same type of political scientist. They are both experts in and students of constitutional law. Second, during the past half dozen years, Jack frequently said that perhaps the most important task of the university president was the appointment of chancellors. This was an all the more remarkable statement because Jack realized, as did his audience, that his performance on this dimension had been flawed. In contrast, at least so far, I think it's fair to say that most of us think President Napolitano has done an excellent job. Chancellor Gilman.
Thank you, Willie, and good afternoon, everyone. I met Jack for the first time when I came to UCI 2 years ago as Provost and Executive Vice Chancellor, but in many respects, I feel as if I had known him for a very long time. I first heard Jack Peltason's name when I was a political science student at UCLA. Jack was a major figure of the study of law and courts from the perspective of political science. His first major contribution was Federal Courts in the Political Process, published in 1955, and it encouraged political scientists to study courts in the larger context of interest group activity and the political process rather than have political scientists try to play little law professor and make comments about whether courts got decisions right. It's actually now referred to as the political process school of the judicial politics field. That was followed by the classic work, 58 Lonely Men, Southern Federal Judges and School Desegregation, a remarkable treatment of the struggles faced by the Southern Federal District Court judges who had the responsibility of implementing Brown versus Board of Education. His textbook, Government by the People, dominated introductory American politics courses for a generation. Similarly, his work Understanding the Constitution, written with his Princeton mentor Edward Corwin, was a constitutional law mainstay. It went through at least 17 editions. Jack was so important in our field that when it was announced that I would be joining UCI, most of my friends in my field didn't say to me, "Congratulations, we think that's great." What they said instead was, "Hey, Jack did a great job there, made our field look good, don't screw up." So just for his towering work as a political scientist and his iconic stature in this discipline, we in the Academy owe Jack Peltason a great debt of gratitude. But we at UC Irvine owe Jack our own special thanks for the profound way in which he shaped this institution. Becoming our Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs in July 1964, more than a year before the first students stepped into the classroom, he led the recruitment of our tremendous, outstanding founding faculty and played a vital role in establishing our academic quality right from the outset. Later as Chancellor, he presided over a period of rapid physical growth and expansion of the campus. There are too many accomplishments to mention, but of course he increased funding for endowed chairs, housed the UC Humanities Research Institute, attracted the national academies to build their Western Center on the campus. He was also instrumental in negotiating a productive relationship with the community for our young campus by founding the UCI Chief Executive Roundtable of Corporate Partners, creating the UCI Medal to recognize contributions both from the university and from community members, and negotiating an agreement with the Irvine Company that led to the creation of the University Research Park. And he did this, as you'll hear over and over today, with remarkable good humor. When I was appointed provost, one of the things that I found is that when you try to explain to someone what a provost is, it's very hard. Most people don't know what a provost is. And I was talking to Willie about this a few weeks after I arrived on the campus. It's weird, I have to explain to people what a provost is. And Willie, of course, said, "Well, Jack had the best explanation for what a provost is that you need." And I said, "Well, tell me." And so, you know, Willie relayed what Jack said. And he said, "Well, people understand that the role of the faculty is to think. And people understand that the role of the chancellor is to speak. And the job of the provost is to make sure that the faculty don't speak and the chancellor doesn't think." I have to say, it was a much funnier joke when I was the provost. It's a tremendous honor, as you can imagine, to serve as one of Jack's successors. I was so grateful, after so many years of studying his remarkable work, to have had the opportunity to tell Jack how much he influenced me as a young scholar and how much I was inspired, not just by his scholarship, but by his commitment to higher education and especially his leadership of this great institution. And it will come as no surprise for you to learn that he had outstanding advice to offer the new kid in town. Jack's loss is deeply felt and it weighs heavily on our community. But we continue to be inspired by his example. He brought to UCI a strong and clear vision of excellence, implemented with shrewd judgment and tempered with that fabulous sense of humor. We miss you, Jack, but you will not be forgotten. And now it is my honor to introduce another of Jack's successors, the president of the University of California, the Honorable Janet Napolitano.
Well, thank you, and thank you for inviting me to participate in this celebration of the life of Jack Peltason. Great universities are not built in a day. They are perpetual works in progress. They are carried on the shoulders of leaders who can navigate the issues of the day, the crisis du jour, while at the same time making sure that the institution keeps moving forward and forward and forward. Jack Peltason was one such leader. Under his stewardship, both the Irvine campus and later the University of California as a whole greatly benefited from his strong shoulders. In my first year as university president, I had the privilege of presenting Jack with the university's highest honor, the Presidential Medal. At the presentation, he was described as a statesman of higher education. In hindsight, this was an understatement. Those who knew Jack best knew him as a passionate champion for UCI and his beloved Anteaters. Anteaters. For the University of California and for public higher education in general. When he spoke, higher education leaders listened. I'll give you one example of his wisdom and his prescience. In an interview conducted in connection with his oral history, Jack remarked as follows, quote, "I think higher education's quality is not accidental. It can be fine-tuned, but essentially the formulas are sound. It doesn't need so much fixing as it needs funding." Amen. And as Howard has mentioned and has been noticed by so many of you, he was a man of great wit. When he was appointed president of the university at age 69, critics questioned whether he was too old to provide effective leadership. In true Peltason candor, he addressed the issue head-on in his accepted speech. "There has been some concern about a generation gap," he said. "I think that concern is exaggerated. I do not have any trouble getting along with older people." I think the Regent's resolution of appreciation adopted on Jack's departure as the 16th president of the University of California captured his many qualities well. It described President Peltason as a man of honesty, decency, and manifest integrity, qualities that have been the hallmark of a long and illustrious career dedicated to the highest principles of duty and public trust. His was a legacy of leadership, it said, marked by persuasiveness, warmth, humor, and a steady concern for the university's welfare. That resolution also appropriately recognized the teamwork of Jack and Susie Peltason. The university, it said, has not only been fortunate to have the benefit of Jack Peltason's dedication and commitment, but it has been graced by the presence of his beloved partner, Susie, a first lady in all respects whose intelligence, warmth, and ready wit have earned many friends for the university. Well said. During turbulent times, Jack stepped into the breach and served both the University of California and the people of California, combining political savvy with strong academic values to carry the university to even greater heights. And his legacies are legion. As now the 20th president of the University of California, all I can say is Jack set the bar awfully high. Well done, Jack Peltason.
Now I get to read a letter from former President Gardner. Ladies and gentlemen, this is President Gardner speaking, not me. I deeply regret that today's celebration of Jack Peltason's life conflicts with the exact time and date of my grandson's graduation from high school in Dallas, Texas. Thank you for allowing me to participate today in this fashion. Jack Peltason was a very important part of my personal and professional life for over 40 years, and his loss will be mourned by more than any of us can imagine. I recall phoning Jack in 1984 to invite his interest in serving as UCI's next chancellor following the retirement of our dear and mutual friend, Chancellor Dan Aldridge. May I parenthetically note, and this is me, Gene Aldridge. Could you stand up, Gene? I've asked her to do a lot of things over the years. She hasn't done any of them, so there's no reason for her to change now. She's ornery but pleasant. I reached Jack, now this is not me, this is Gardner. I reached Jack in the Virgin Islands where he and his family were vacationing from his position as president of the American Council on Education in Washington, D.C. His initial response to my inquiry was that life was pretty good for him and the family. Just listen to the ocean in the background, he said by way of illustration. How would you like to hear the ocean 12 months a year? Not just one, I answered. The rest is history. Chancellor Peltason, along with his remarkable and supportive wife, Susie, served this campus with all the energy, talent, and commitment that could possibly be brought to bear in behalf of UCI students, faculty, and staff, while also strengthening the quality of UCI's intellectual and programmatic endeavors and its capacity to serve an even broader swath of well-qualified students seeking to study here. During this same time, he was an indispensable and always reliable colleague during my years of service as UC's president from 1983 to 1992. Jack was always ready to help, offering wise and thoughtful advice, seeking at all times to discover not unworkable answers to our problems, but workable solutions instead. Traits of character, courage, and wisdom that prompted the UC Regents to appoint Jack as the university's 16th president upon my retirement in 1992. He served until his retirement in 1995, years marked by physical stresses and a range of issues and challenges, but formidable as they were, President Peltason never flinched, but did his duty as he saw it and to the university's great gain. We will miss our cherished friend whose life we celebrate today, but our memories of him and his good works in behalf of UC and the nation's colleges and universities will be celebrated always and never forgotten. Signed, David P. Gardner. The word university comes from the Latin word universitas, which has nothing whatsoever to do with the universality of knowledge. Rather, the word universitas means community. Jack Walter Peltason understood that intuitively. It defined the egalitarian way he treated faculty, staff, and students within the university, as well as his construction of a larger university community that included the people who lived and worked around UCI. His efforts in this respect are noteworthy and will be explored by our next three speakers. After we hear from them, we will then hear from a couple of colleagues and from a former student. Now, in line with one of the Peltisonisms that is included within your program, the one that indicates that time passes much more slowly for the listener than for the speaker, each guest has been asked to limit his or her remarks to no more than 5 minutes. To aid in this respect, I had requested that a remote control trapdoor be built behind this podium and that I be provided with the clicker. I must inform you that my request was denied. The first of our speakers comes from the community as Mr. Tim Cooley. For years, Mr. Cooley led a lunch group of business and community people who got together with Jack on a regular basis. Among his many positions in the business community, let me simply mention that he was president of and CEO of what was to become the Orange County Business Council. Mr. Cooley.
How do you follow him? Thank you, Dr. Schoenfeld. I appreciate it. President Napolitano, Chancellor Gilman, Susie, and a wonderful family. Good afternoon. Jack was a dear friend who gave great advice. You've heard some of it here today. I didn't know we were going to be turning this into an amateur comedy night at the comedy club, but you'll hear more of it, and you can see from the smiles on every picture the grin that is typically Jack. Jack was a dear friend who gave great advice, including the secret to giving a good speech, advice that I'll try to follow today. I first got to know Jack in the early 90s. He was a member of a core group of business, government, and academic leaders brought together by then Orange County Supervisor Harriet Weider, and I must say I see Supervisor Marion Bergeson here, and who succeeded then Harriet. That core group went on to form Partnership 2010, a think tank focused on regional economic competitiveness in Orange County in Southern California. As Dr. Schoenfeld mentioned, it was the precursor to what is today the Orange County Business Council. I was asked to be the founding president, and Jack agreed to be on my board of directors. Jack wasn't only an engaged board member and advisor, he became a friend. And it's the friendship, insights, and Jack's wit that I'll remember most. To this day, I keep a quote from Jack that I printed and framed and have moved and hung in whatever office I've occupied. It says, "Everything we think we know and everything we think we believe must be continually challenged, critically assessed, and changed if necessary." I can't begin to tell you how many times I've looked at that plaque and it's affected my day-to-day life. As Dr. Schoenfeld mentioned, we had a small group of friends who would get together once a month for lunch to catch up and discuss the state of the world. We solved many of the world's problems, but unfortunately, none of us took notes. We called ourselves Du Bois, and our lunches broached subjects all over the board. It seemed that no matter what the topic, one of our gang had some sort of direct, relevant, personal experience with it and wasn't shy about sharing it with us. It made for some fascinating discussions. Our lunch group developed into some deep and lasting friendships. We lost some of the participants over the years, Paul Silverman from the university, Tom Wilk, and now Jack. We've shared life experiences, the ups, the downs, the good, the bad, the deeply personal, and the normal clutter and concerns of day-to-day life. Also over the years, Jack, Susan, and I would get together for Sunday brunch at Britta's, joined by family and friends whenever they were in town. Whether it was for birthday celebrations, card games with the guys, or to watch an occasional football game, Jack always had that ready smile and a playful sense of humor. It was during one of the nights we got together to watch a game that Jack had some fun with us. Jack's Parkinson's was advancing and he was having a difficult time talking. He had just loaded a text-to-speech application onto his laptop. All of a sudden, during halftime, the laptop started making strange sounds and at full blast, just gibberish with the volume turned full up. We looked at Jack and he had that big smile on his face and was laughing. Turns out he was making up and typing in nonsense words and he said he just wanted to hear what they sounded like. Always inquisitive, Jack being Jack. I've been able to get back to Orange County pretty regularly since I left 6 years ago for Wisconsin, where the winters are long and for all the political scientists in the audience, the politics are a full contact sport that make the Packers look like a high school dodgeball team. Whenever I'd get back, though, we'd get the boys together to catch up, and I'd get a chance to visit with Jack and Susie. It made no difference that it became progressively more difficult for Jack to communicate. He enjoyed being part of the group, was there at the table with us, hearing what was going on, and being part of all of our lives. Jack had a wonderful take on life. I recall a couple of noteworthy Jackisms on the subject. Life. It is what it is. Don't make a big fuss about it, he said. After all, it's just a sexually transmitted fatal disease. During Jack's 80th birthday celebration here on campus at the Beckman Center, he expounded on his philosophy on growing older. Now, the rest of my speech is that philosophy, but then they printed it in your program, so I'm not going to have a chance or take go over my time to discuss it. But it seemed like a good philosophy, and Jack talked about everything being over 80 bonus years, so he kept and abided by it during his 11 bonus years. Jack influenced many lives over his life as a teacher, administrator, associate, and friend at Smith College, University of Illinois, where actually we found out, I found out later in life that we had a lot in common. We were both born in St. Louis. While he was teaching at University of Illinois, I was learning how to ride a bike up the street in Paxton, Illinois. So there was a lot of shared history. On to the American Council on Education, UCI, and of course the UC system. He had a tremendous respect for academia, for students, the faculty, and staff. But most of all, he loved UCI and the friends he made here in Orange County. You know, we all go through life meeting and interacting with multitudes of people. Mostly in passing, and mostly, if we're honest, eventually forgettable. Then there are those rare individuals who make a lasting, indelible mark on our lives. Someone we connect with in some special way. Someone who contributes a building block to the very core foundation of who we are. For whatever reason, Jack's one of those rare people for me, and I'm sure for many of you. Someone who is now a lasting, permanent part of my very foundation, and someone who makes me better than I was for knowing them. Jack's advice on giving a good speech, you'll be happy to hear this. Keep it short and never say anything dumb. I hope I followed that advice today. You're missed and remembered, Jack, not only by me, but also by the hundreds, thousands, even tens of thousands, whose lives have been changed in a myriad of meaningful ways. God bless you.
The second member of the community who will speak today is Safi Qureshi. Mr. Qureshi was a co-founder and CEO of AST Research and one of the very first Orange County technology leaders to work closely with Jack and with UCI. Given the long-term importance of technology for the university and its relationship, he was an absolute path-breaking contributor in that respect. I should also point out to you, specifically because he asked me not to mention it, that doing these monthly lunches, he always picked up the tab, showing a kind of generosity to keep everyone else talking. Thank you so very much for doing that, and would you please come up?
Good afternoon, President Napolitano, Chancellor Gilman, the Peltason family, Susie Peltason, friends and colleagues over the years, good afternoon. When I moved to California in the 70s from the red state called Texas, Orange County was a real culture shock. But for Anita and myself, Orange County adopted us, and UCI adopted us. This is where we found our partner, Tom Ewan, a UCI alum, and Albert Wong, a graduate of Cal State Fullerton. If you go back to the 80s, Orange County was considered the most Republican county in the nation. Most business people in Orange County looked at UCI as a classic ivory tower run by liberals. Jack, coming back as a chancellor, reached out to the business community. And for a young immigrant engineer turned CEO, a call from a chancellor was earth-shaking. Jack is reaching out to us, but he truly adopted me to the UCI family. One of the key things that he taught me and I've shared with people around the world is talking about American history. And he says, Safi, the knowledge producers and the wealth producers in this great country have worked together since the mid-19th century when the Land-Grant College Act was passed, I believe under President Lincoln, that agricultural colleges were set up, the professor would develop a new seed, I as a farmer go plant it, I have a good crop, I support it. And I believe that that trend of knowledge producers and wealth producers is continuing to make this country shine. At UCI, at Stanford, all our great research universities. In learning to look at education, as I look at this room, most of us are here because of the family we were born in. I was born in a two-bedroom house in Karachi, but my father was more educated than I am today. My mother, as a Muslim girl in India in 1940s, was a sports champion. But the most important thing was that I had a shelter, I had a chance for education. I could have born in another home in Karachi, another village, and I could be going through trash. So as I look at my luck, it is the family that gave birth to me. The accident, as Tim Cooley said. I came to this country and I have been benefiting since age 19 to all the amazing opportunities that I have seen. Jack's message about knowledge and education led our family to look at Sesame Street and work with Children's Television Workshop to create Sesame Seed programs in Urdu for kids in Pakistan in the 90s. That same way to transfer knowledge, now we are working with Khan Academy to take their math and science courses to transform the lives of people who are not as lucky as all of us in this room. In looking at digital knowledge and online education, which is our passion now as a family, somebody reminded me not too long ago that if you look at a great textbook, as we talked about Jack's textbook, it is the knowledge of some of the finest academics who most of the average colleges cannot afford. So the next best thing is the textbook from that academic. I believe that that same knowledge, now captured in a digital form, allows millions and millions who will never be able to attend some of the best universities to get the second best knowledge from those amazing minds. Another thing I learned from Jack was deep optimism about human nature. I never saw him worried about this country, or for that matter, the world at large. The part of the world where I come from, you see in the news every day. Something is blowing up. But my question to all of you is to see if you remember this young girl called Malala. How many of you know that? So let me expand on that story. When I left Pakistan in the 70s, for girls to go to college, engineering, medicine, there was a quota system, 5%, 10%. The data for today, in majority of the professional colleges, from business to law to accounting, not only that majority of the class is women, but they are topping the class. In the 90s, even though I have been a lifelong Republican, I had a chance to serve under President Clinton's Export Advisory Council. And it was a good experience to look at Washington, and I would always ask Jack, what assignment should I take, which organization should I join? Just not too long ago, I saw President Clinton on one of my news programs, the Jon Stewart's Daily Show. And one of the key things President Clinton said as he was looking at development around the world, he said, don't confuse the headlines with the trend lines. And folks, I can share with you that as I travel to different developing countries, the amount of education that has been given to women, I truly believe that this is their century. And I, as a man, want to do everything in my power to empower women in every part of the world. Because we as men have run this planet for a few hundred thousand years, and we always look at world as a zero-sum game. If China is getting ahead, if India is getting ahead, that means we are feeling insecure. If you talk to women, my mother, my wife, my sister, they're always looking at the planet as a whole. Today, for the first time, I believe we have the resources to develop the human capital so that I don't see any shortage of water or oil or food. It's all a shortage of ideas, and you guys at these universities are creating the next generation of minds to build that capacity. So about 5 years ago, I stopped reading all newspapers. And one young person that I work with said, why the hell don't you read newspapers? And I had to pause for a second. I said, the news of today, the bombs blowing up in the Middle East, whatever we are seeing, other than natural disasters, the seeds for those news was planted years ago, decades ago, sometimes centuries ago. And I could be very upset. But I want to work with young people and all the technology, the capability we have, and the women, and the senior citizens to look at the world 50 years from now. I would be gone just like Jack, but I want to plant new seeds. I truly believe that Jack's legacy is what he inspired in me about education, about working with universities, and about global optimism. That is the best way to celebrate his life. I'm curious to see how many of you had a chance to learn Jack's bonus years. You did? How many of you know that you can go to McDonald's and get senior coffee? I was telling Anita that after reading Jack's article, now I feel guilty asking for that because Jack said I should not be asking for any favors. So I believe that for this university, for this country, and for this planet at large, the best is ahead of us. Thank you so much.
The third member of the community who will speak today is Larry Thomas. Jack introduced me to Larry more than 10 years ago, and since then we've developed a relationship which I have found very rewarding and which he has suffered through. Mr. Thomas is the long-term senior vice president of the Irvine Company in charge of communications. Prior to that time, he was the former press secretary to Vice President George Herbert Walker Bush, to Governor George Duke Majan, and to Governor Pete Wilson. As you can see, his credentials in the Democratic Party are impeccable. Larry Thomas has special insights into the relationships developed between the Irvine Company's Donald Bren and Jack Peltason, a relationship that had been directly comparable to the sort of relationship which had been established at the turn of the 19th century into the 20th century between John D. Rockefeller and the University of Chicago. I'm delighted to present Larry Thomas.
My sweet daughter, who is with it and knows about such things, suggested that I might enjoy this experience in high honor more if I carefully scrubbed any trigger words from my remarks. So I did that, only to have my well-meaning and irrepressible friend Willie use at least three and possibly five in my introduction. So I guess all restraint is lifted. That opens the door to this observation, and I'm not one who likes to sit around and go, Jack would really like this, and Jack would really like that, but truly, I think he's surely smiling on us today for at least one reason. The organizers of this memorial for one of the world's foremost scholars on democracy and political science found a way to monetize this event by contracting with the Republican National Committee to use it as a test format for the Republican Party's primary debates. You can start my 5 minutes on Jack now, okay? Jack, a lifetime student of political power, once told me the most important responsibility for the president of the University of California was to select new chancellors, as has been mentioned. It came in a conversation where I wasn't quite sure that that was his favorite job that he ever did, but he did it well. He said he believed that chancellors have more control over their campuses, but power is diffused among such diverse interests as the Academic Senate, the deans, tenured professors, the associated students, labor unions, and others like the old lions on this campus, including Willie Schoenfeld. So how does one successfully run a University of California campus? How does a chancellor get anything accomplished, let alone big, complex things, at a time when a university is an infant trying to grow up and find its way? In my mind, it's simple. And Jack was the epitome of it. The blunt power of great ideas, coupled with the irresistible power of personal persuasion. Jack was blessed with both in abundance. I want to share just one example with you today. I had the joy in the last couple of years of visiting with Jack, and about a year ago, he tapped out on that iPad of his the following note as part of a discussion we were having about his relationship with our friend Donald Bren, the owner of the Irvine Company. He wrote, quote, "The state of California gave us resources to make UCI a good university, and private donors have made it a greater university. Donald Bren and the Irvine Company were among the most significant," close quote. Now, whether it was fate or karma, convergence, divine intervention, good luck, or civil happenstance, the timing in the early 80s of Jack's return to UCI as chancellor and Donald Bren taking majority control of the Irvine Company was fortuitous. Both men had a deep understanding and respect for the audacious idea underway to build from scratch a new city surrounding a new university on the barren hillsides and valleys around us. Both men were dreamers, both optimists, both were builders. They knew their stuff and what they wanted to achieve. Most important, they liked, they respected, and they trusted each other. They were determined to do something very special during their time at BAT. They instinctively knew that a great city and a great university would boost each other. They knew, too, they needed each other to get the job done even better. They did many things during Jack's tenure, both here and beyond, but it was the nurturing of human capital, not bricks and mortar, that became the focus of the most important Bren-Peltason collaboration. It grew out of Jack's core belief that he expressed to me, and I think to many, that, quote, "There really is no secret about what it takes to build an exceptional university. You recruit an outstanding faculty and bright students, and you bring them together," close quote. So Jack and Donald hatched the idea of a generous perpetual endowment to fund academic chairs and award them in a way to assure that this growing university could both attract and also retain world-class scholars. They would be called Bren Fellows and later renamed Bren Scholars and now Bren Professors. Among the first were Sherry Rowland and Francisco Ayala. As the kids say, since I only have 5 minutes, Google them all and you'll be blown away. Endowment funds would provide an annual income supplement to support significant research, travel for seminars and symposiums, and the hiring of graduate assistants. It is currently envisioned that more than 30 endowed Bren chairs at UCI will be filled as pledges and income are realized. Wrote Jack on his iPad, quote, "The big thought was to," quote, "attract and to keep," close quote, "big talent." Donald's priority for university support had been refined and refocused on investing in renowned faculty. Jack said further, it sent a clear signal that UCI was going to play in the big leagues, close quote. Unsaid, of course, because of Jack's humility, was that Jack understood what was needed to boost UCI into the top tier of the nation's public research universities. And his gifted, persuasive teaching ability helped Donald Bren refine and refocus his considerable support, and natural support, I might add, for this university. Donald, in fact, embraced the idea and created subsequent Bren Professor chairs at UCSB, Caltech, Chapman University, and others. Each of the recipients are academic giants. After Jack had retired, Donald valued his wisdom and advice so much that he invited him to be a member of the board of his Bren Foundation. Knowing him for 20 years, that's a high honor, and it tells you more than anything else I could say. Isn't that a marvelous story with so many lessons for us to consider? You know, it's taught that God has a purpose for every living man and woman, and it is up to each of us, with the help of others, to discover our purpose, our gifts, to nurture them, and pursue that purpose with abandon for a true lifetime of joy and satisfaction, as well as for the benefit of others. It should not go without saying that it helps enormously to have the support of an angel, someone named Susie, who lifted him up and helped him through so many challenges. Jack was a wise, kind, humble, and positive presence for us all, whether we were a big fish, like most of the people on this stage and in this audience, or just a little minnow like me. Jack, mission accomplished.
Makes me want to say some of my best friends are Republicans. Upon his retirement from the presidency of the university, Jack returned to his home in Irvine. He focused his intellectual activity on the then-developing Center for the Study of Democracy, working closely with its founding director, Russell Dalton, to enrich the center's research activities, graduate training, and community outreach. Peltason and Dalton were a very successful team that created a valuable University of California organized research unit. Now I'm very pleased to introduce Jack's closest scholarly colleague at UCI, Russell Dalton.
Well, I'd like to thank the Chancellor and Susie for letting me contribute to the celebration today. And all of us here are friends of Jack. Although if Jack were here, he would correct me and say, no, it's really friends of Jack and Susie, because he would constantly talk about how they were a team, how they did things together that benefited the university. And I think it was part of his larger sense of the importance of family. I told him, I think, that I got to learn all the grandchildren by visiting with Jack and hearing stories about the grandchildren. And when he came back, he was in his 70s and was running circles around all of us and traveling, flying back to the East Coast. And I asked him once, why is he flying so much to all these meetings? And he said, it's very simple. There's a grandchild nearby that I can visit after the trip is over. So this was part of Jack's personal life that showed through as a colleague that provided a model. And on one of those trips, he came back and told me it was somewhere in the Midwest. And according to Jack, the story was that Susie had been dating someone else when she was also getting to know Jack. And Jack on this trip had said, aren't you really glad that you didn't marry so-and-so, because we got to be Chancellor and President of the United States? And then as Jack tells the story, he said, Susie immediately said, who's to say if I didn't marry him, he would have become president of the University of California. You've heard from other people about Jack's administrative and community accomplishments as the faculty member on the program. I thought I would talk about Jack as a friend and a faculty member in the perspective of what we saw in the trenches when Jack came back from his time at UCI and worked in developing the Center for the Study of Democracy, as well as 1,000 other things that were going on in his life. Working with Jack was one of the best parts of my entire career. It was like being able to play catch with Babe Ruth, taking a class from a Nobel Prize winner. He was just exceptional as a human being, as a scholar, a real role model in so many different ways. There was this sense of warmth that Jack had that was a humaneness that one didn't see in everyone that had reached his stature in life. There was this deep intellectual interest that he had. If there was a conference or a talk in political science, even as chancellor, he would sneak up and show up in the back of the room to hear what was the forefronts of research. He had an understanding of what it took to make a good university, and he had a sense of humility and humor. And if I'm not betraying something, when he left to become UCOP president, I was chair at the time and wrote him a letter and said, when you come back, well, there's a place waiting for you. And Jack wrote back, thank you for offering to keep a seat in the department warm and to save an undergraduate course for me. Several hundred undergraduates will be just the calm I need after the presidency. So I think we'll make the same offer to President Napolitano. Jack's career was in benefiting others. And so what I want to do is talk about him in three levels. First, to our students. Jack was, throughout his entire career, an educator. It was mentioned today that he is co-author of Government by the People, and one of his co-authors is in the audience with us today. This is not just a book. This is a book that is probably the best-selling book ever in the history of political science. Over 1 million copies, which means millions and millions of American college students learned about American government from Jack and David Magleby and his other colleagues. And one has to think that if they had the benefit that we had to learn it directly from Jack, maybe politics wouldn't be in such bad shape as it is today. Jack and Susie also institutionalized their support for students with the formation of the Peltason Fellowship. And Jack was insistent it was the Jack and Susie Peltason Fellowship that enabled young people to come to UCI to study democracy, to develop careers, and then go out and teach and do research for the rest of their lives. There's been, I think, 24 Peltason Fellows now to date that have come from this fellowship endowment, that have gone to schools like Wellesley, University of Connecticut, University of Tennessee, Göttingen University, and around the world that are able to pursue a career because of Jack and Susie's generosity. As a faculty member, we saw how Jack brought a commitment to the goals of the university and all of the things that he did. He created as chancellor an environment. When I came here, it was like I was moving from the minor leagues to the big leagues, because you could see the manager of the team knew how to get into the playoffs. And to reward that, as Larry Thomas mentioned, the Bren Fellows, Donald Bren generously created the Donald Bren Jack Peltason Chair that now continues on the research side Jack's contribution. And last, one of the most important things that Jack did was build bridges to the community. And when he came back, he helped develop the community board for the center, helped reach out to bring people to UCI from Bill Podlick and Larry Thomas and Marion Bergeson and a host of other community people who brought their energy, their insights, their networks into the university to help develop the center. Meredith Kachigian, a variety of others that I can't even remember all of the names because there were so many. And to his credit, the Hewlett Foundation built on that to establish the Peltason Lectureship so that we could bring leading national and international scholars to UCI every year to maintain this dialogue with the community. And it began with two friends of Jack, Senator Paul Simon from Illinois and Jean Kirkpatrick, who worked in different administrations on different sides of the aisle. And it continued on with Ted Kennedy and last year's President Napolitano. So in a very real sense, Jack's legacy lives on through the good works that he and Susie have done and the way that we've been able to institutionalize his memory and his contributions through these various activities. So I want to leave with two lessons that I've learned from Jack. I mean, the hard part is to narrow it down to two. This was an incredible experience to work with him in many ways. And the two lessons, since most of us are in a university or have ties to the university, I saw Jack in dozens of meetings, and he always seemed to have a gyroscope of what was important, what was frills, what was the heart of the matter. And I asked him once, and he said, it's simple, there's three simple rules. When he was chancellor and UC president, he was guided by three simple questions. Did this help students learn? Did this help faculty teach better? And did it improve the quality of research at the University of California? And if it did that, it was a good thing. And if it didn't, he would pass it off to a provost, probably. Last, I want to share Jack's description to UCI, which you might have heard him say yourself. He always said UCI was a special place. It's a place where the sun always shines. The parks are named Aldrich, and the streets are named Peltason. So as you drive out today or in the future, and you drive down Peltason Drive, you can think of that as a way to celebrate Jack. Thank you very much.
In my role as filling in lacuna, which had been left by previous speakers, Professor Dalton failed to identify the name of Susie Peltison's suitor, who she turned down for Jack Peltison. And that was, if I am correct, Poindexter, is that correct? Just for the record. I arrived on the UC campus in 1970. Since then, I heard gossip about how every single one of our chancellors, with only one exception, was going to become the next president of the University of California. Oddly, the only UCI chancellor about whom such gossip did not exist was Jack Walter Peltason. To talk a bit about his presidency, we are fortunate to have former assistant to the president, Pat Pelfrey, with us today. Included in your program is the beautiful and powerful one-page obituary which she wrote for Jack, which captures succinctly and brilliantly his nature and his contributions. Ms. Pelfrey.
Good afternoon. I want to thank the Peltason family and this wonderful campus for the privilege and the honor of talking a little bit about Jack today. I promise I will be brief, although fortunately the stories about Jack are endless, and as other speakers have mentioned, the hard thing is cutting it down. I want to begin, first of all, by building on the previous speaker, talking about Jack and Susie and UCI, because when he became president, one of the first things we learned about him and about Susie was how deep their roots were in this beautiful campus and how much they loved their service here. In fact, when Jack came to the office of the president, he told us that the only thing that eased his sadness in leaving the Irvine campus was the knowledge that everyone here had already heard all of his jokes. Fortunately, he quickly grasped the idea that the office of the president offered broad new vistas for deploying his repertoire, and believe me, he made the best possible use of that. Several people have mentioned that he became president in tumultuous times. That was probably an understatement. At his first meeting with the Board of Regents, he said, "I know the board wanted me to hit the ground running, but I didn't know they meant running and decking." And the 3 years, the three Peltason years, there was a lot of running, there was a lot of decking, but there was also a lot of standing up to tough problems and knotty conundrums, all of which Jack handled beautifully. It will come as no surprise, because this is obviously an audience that knew Jack, that as president, he did not lean towards the imperial style. In fact, the office of the president was in the Kaiser Building in Oakland in those days, and the president's immediate office and the executive offices were on the 22nd floor. Jack referred to all the floors under the 22nd floor as the people's floors. At our Christmas party, he introduced the General Counsel of the Regents as my lawyer, your lawyer, the people's lawyers. We appreciated that, but we didn't push it too hard. I also think it is significant, and I learned a great deal from hearing about Jack as a political scientist, because that is something I want to mention at least briefly. It was so apparent to me when I got to know Jack how important his discipline was to him and how alive his discipline was. When I talked to Jack about this, and I had the pleasure of working with him a little bit on some of the revisions of his book, it was obvious that all of this was as fresh to him as if he were an assistant professor, and it elicited as much passion from him as if he were a very young man and embarked on a cause. James Madison was one of his heroes, he told me, and like Madison, Jack believed in American democracy. He believed in universities as one of the greatest achievements of that democracy, and he believed in the potential to inspire a commitment to the common good on the part of ordinary people, not just a commitment to their own self-interest. The 3 years he spent as president subjected this last belief to a very rigorous test, but that didn't slow Jack down a bit. He responded with a determination to compromise, and in fact, he used to say, this one really struck me, he used to say that standing on principle is a wonderful thing, but insisting on principle means that you are never willing to compromise, you are never willing to move towards the other person's point of view, and what Jack excelled at was being able to see the other person's point of view. The wonderful quote from his father about how much longer 30 minutes feels when you're listening than when you are speaking was typical of Jack's approach, because he had a special gift for listening to other people, for taking their point of view into account. It was very important to his work as president, and he was superb at it. But what was truly, to me, remarkable about Jack was the grace with which he dealt with the many different problems involving budgets, involving politics, involving governance that seemed to strike the University of California every week. We used to talk about the buzzsaw du jour, and it was almost literally true. Obviously, there's no time today to talk about those, but anyone interested in the battles he fought on behalf of the University of California, on how ferociously he worked to reconcile partisan politics with academic principles, should read his oral history. And if you think that an oral history by Jack Peltason will be not only enlightening but also entertaining, it's a pretty good bet. I think that because he had spent decades studying the dynamics of democratic life, not to mention the dynamics of universities, he was able to take the long view of things. He was fairly philosophical, both about political victories and political defeats. He never saw either as permanent. He always saw either a victory or a defeat as a momentary pause in tensions of various kinds that were likely to reemerge. And so it was important always to be ready to defend the University of California, always to give it your best work and your best commitment. One of the things he used to say, it takes a minute, but you'll get it. He used to say, today's problems are yesterday's reforms. And it gives you an idea of the kind of long-range perspective he took. One of Jack's predecessors, University of California President Clark Kerr, said, the difference between being a chancellor and being a president is that presidents have no rooting sections. Jack had many problems as president, but that was not one of them. He inspired loyalty, he inspired love, he really did inspire the best work, not only of his staff, but of other people too. He was a model for all of us. And he was also just plain old irresistibly likable for a lot of reasons, but not just for his wit and his wisdom, but also for the kind of person he was. Because as other people have said, there was virtually no distance between the official Jack and the unofficial Jack, between the public president and the private person. He was always the same person. Always thoughtful, direct, friendly, open, likable, ever ready to share his enthusiasms for In-N-Out burgers, which he used to proudly point out to us Northerners was a Southern California company. As we celebrate his remarkable life, what emerges most clearly about him is how valiantly he defended the university and how strongly he represented the highest values of academic life. But I would not want to leave you with the wrong impression. We did live through some very difficult years, and I'm sure for Jack and his indispensable partner, Susie, there were times when they felt very discouraged and really had to work hard to pick themselves up. But from both of them, we always got the sentiment that it was a joyful burden for them, that their excitement about the University of California, their love for its campuses, for the university as a whole, never wavered. And if you were fortunate enough to work with them in service to this great university, it might have felt, in some respects, like the worst of times, but the chance to work with them made many, many days feel like the very best of times. Thank you.
Our penultimate speaker is the person outside of the family, at least here today, who I think has known and worked with Jack the longest, his first doctoral student, and what a doctoral student he was. Lucius Barker has had an unusually distinguished academic career that includes, to be brief, election to the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, holding a prestigious named chair at Stanford University, and having served as president of the American Political Science Association. These three roles, I'm sure, speak only of a small part of his extraordinary contributions. Professor Barker.
I'd like to talk today about how one good man can make a difference. I want to repeat that again, how one good man can make a difference. Some years ago, all I need to know I learned in kindergarten reminds me that all I ever need to know about higher education I learned from my mentor, Jack Peltason. When my brother Twilight W. Barker Jr. and I completed college in racially segregated schools in Louisiana, we could not enroll in higher education institutions in Louisiana to pursue a PhD degree. For that reason, the state of Louisiana paid our out-of-state tuition to attend the University of Illinois. What a blessing. Because it was at the University of Illinois where we met Jack Peltason. Jack took us under his wings and made me a teaching assistant. Throughout the early years of my teaching career, I kept in contact with Jack. He always knew where to make contact with me. In 1968, while teaching at the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee, Jack called and asked me to join him at the University of Illinois to become his chief assistant. Those were the turbulent years of student sit-in demonstrations and racial equality and justice. Time will not permit me to tell you the real depths of Jack's character, the unwavering strength of purpose. Jack was a man. Simply put, he was a good man. This period could have been a turning point in his life, but he never showed any signs of giving up. He would always speak positive words and met every challenge with a solution for good. As a result, he was able to meet student demands purposefully. With the sanction of the Board of Trustees, Jack made a commitment to enroll 500 minority students. This commitment became known as Project 500. Jack's commitment proves that one good man can really make a difference. Now to Susie, Nancy, Tim, and Jill, spouses and children and grandchildren, I want to thank you for allowing me to retell some of the many challenges and heroic events that I shared with Jack. He was an exceptionally brilliant, kind, and committed person, and just dared to make a difference for the good. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Barker. To conclude today's formal program, we're all delighted to welcome Jack's son, Timothy Walter Hopkins Peltason. He is the class of 1949 professor in ethics and professor of English at Wellesley College, a Harvard AB, and a Yale PhD, Tim early in life must have shown a strong streak of rebelliousness by refusing to follow in Jack's Princetonian footsteps. Tim?
I thought you were going to mention when I wanted to switch out of economics into English. Because he had said, earlier, he said, I don't want to ever put any pressure on you. He told me when I was in high school, you can get your PhD in any field you want. He said, but then when I wanted to be an English literate, it turned out that was actually, he didn't have that in mind, but he made his peace with it. Thank you all very much on behalf of my mother and my sisters, Nancy Elliott and Jill Redding. I want to thank all of you for being here today to join with us in remembering and celebrating my father. I want to thank particularly the people in the Chancellor's office, Chancellor Gilman, but Mike Arias and Linda Grishkoff, the people who I know from our email exchanges really did all of the work to make this happen. We are very appreciative of that. And I want to thank really the whole Irvine community that my father loved so much, and that so richly returned that affection over the last 50 years and more. It's given such comfort to my sisters and me in the years since my father's retirement to know that though we were far away from them as they faced the inevitable trials of age, my parents were living here, surrounded by people who knew and appreciated and loved them. And you really did know and appreciate my father. It's been wonderful today. Not just to hear him praised and remembered in such detail and with such generosity, but beyond that, to hear him praised by all of you for just the same qualities that we loved and took such delight in, all of us who had the immense blessing of being parts of the family that he and my mother created together in their 68 years of marriage. We all knew the same person. Such an extraordinary combination of exceptional achievement with exceptional decency and modesty. He was so modest, in fact, so completely unself-important that it was sometimes possible for those of us in the family to lose track of how really impressive his achievements were. When he was chosen as president of the University of California, I remember friends saying to me sort of sympathetically, has it been difficult for you over these years to have a father who was so exceptionally accomplished in your field? And I thought, it must have been, I guess. I went back, I thought, gee, he really is extraordinarily accomplished now that you mentioned. His greatest interest always was in us and what we had done. He prized that and valued it. It did sort of come late to me to occur to me. He did remarkable things. We've heard about him, so I'll try to go briefly, but I know you'll indulge me if I mention a few of his achievements, even at the cost of repetition. It does me good to think and speak of them. It was by the time he was 36 that he had done all that work in political science that Chancellor Gilman talked about, founded a whole subfield, written that textbook, Government by the People, that was of such inestimable benefit, not only to the millions of students who studied, but to the significant number of children and grandchildren whose tuition it paid and is still paying. And then when he was just 36, already a full professor at Urbana, somebody at the University of Illinois, he never knew who, he hadn't been a department chair, somebody just looked at him, a faculty member who had never done any administrative work, and decided with great and consequential prescience that he maybe had what it took to be an administrator. He spent 4 years then in Urbana as the Dean of Liberal Arts and Sciences before Ivan Hinderacher came knocking. I remember that when they were sitting in the living room at our house in Urbana, my parents were very happy that day because it had been a lifelong dream of theirs, or a decades-long dream anyway, to return to Southern California, or to come to Southern California, where my mother had been born. Ivan helped him to realize that dream. He came here in 1964, so a year before the place opened. I was 13 when we moved here, just old enough to enjoy listening to him talk about the great opportunity that he was being given by Ivan, really, but by Dan Aldrich, whom he admired so much and always spoke about with such affection and such respect. That opportunity to help, to be part of the team that would build from the dust of the Irvine Ranch this great living community. It was a job that excited him and that humbled him, but that didn't scare him as much as I would have expected it to. He was always bold at the same time that he was modest. He made one big decision after another as the Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs about what subjects to emphasize, about who to hire, how to take best advantage of the remarkable opportunity he'd been given here. He never lost his sense of wonder about that, his sense of how lucky he'd been to be present at the creation of such an extraordinary thing, to have been privileged to be among those who set the course of a great university. He moved on then when he was 43 to become the first chancellor of the Urbana campus of the University of Illinois, where he had a chance to work again with Lucius. Wherever he worked, they always wanted him to come back. So he started a new phase of his career then, a phase which for almost 30 years he was CEO of one educational institution or another. At Illinois, it was 10 wonderful but tough years, weathering the late 60s, an era of student protests, but also sustaining a legacy of excellence and starting many different and new programs. And you're right, Project 500 was always the one nearest to his heart and the one he was especially proud of. Then 7 years as president of the American Council on Education, which gave my parents a chance to live in Washington, D.C., a place they both loved and a place that was especially meaningful to him. He always had such tremendous respect for the process of government and was thrilled to be at the seat of government, making what seemed to him the always necessary case for higher education to the world at large. And among his many accomplishments at ACE was the founding of a business higher education roundtable. And started similar institutions here and elsewhere. It was typical of his vision to see that higher education would be receiving less and less support from public sources and would need to look more and more to the business world for partnerships. And it was typical of his temperament to want to bring together two communities that were often divided by mistrust and misunderstanding of each other's missions. He always talked about that faculty members, he thought, and university people and business people had so much to learn from each other if they could just be brought together to such important worlds. And then, you know, what was perhaps the happiest of all of his many moves, he was called back here as the UCI second chancellor, having such distinguished footsteps to follow in with Dan. And I don't have to tell all of you what great years those were. You know better than I do what his life was like here. What I can add from my own observation is that I really do think, actually, for a variety of years, that those years as chancellor here were in some ways the most uncomplicatedly happy and positive of his whole administrative career. He just, everything was clicking, and he was so happy and grateful to be here, and wonderful time. He had a wonderful time at the office of the president, too, but those were stormy and difficult times, hard work, but he did it well. I'm so grateful to Pat Pelfrey for what she said today and for what she wrote about in that in the piece that's in the program about the time that he spent there. His was an extraordinary career, but an even more extraordinary character, I think. My sisters and I have compared notes over the years, and we've all, on lots of occasions, whenever we came to visit, if there was some kind of official dinner or gathering, and there almost always was during the years of his various chancellorships, we'd get invited along. And whenever we were at a dinner with my parents, a big gathering, somebody in the course of the evenings, or often more than one somebody, would come and pull us aside and say, just have to tell you how much we love working with your father. It was often, especially people who were in support positions, who worked for him, would always pull us aside to tell us, we just love your parents. And then they'd tell us why. Always mention his wit, easy and fast and spontaneous and utterly his own, often incisive in its way of capturing a small or large truth on the fly and in a genuinely new way, but never mean-spirited and never deployed as a form of attack or exclusion. His funny remarks didn't put you on guard. They put you at ease and invited you into a world of shared good feeling and understanding. And that's connected to the second thing that people always remarked on about him, his kindness, which was unusual, I think, for a person renowned for his wit to be also renowned for his kindness, but so it was with my father. He understood deeply that other people were the center of their own worlds, that they had equal claim, every one of them, to consideration. And that sense of consideration was an extension of his sense of perspective, his ability to see not just beyond the moment, but beyond himself, to remember that everybody in the room, wherever he was, had a story of their own, a history. He was always a great people watcher. I think he got that from his mother. He loved to play a game when we were out at dinner, watching people go by at Disneyland or at the mall, of guessing at the histories of the people we saw, inventing family narratives, offering his own shrewd, if completely speculative, explanations of the complex relationships between the oddly assorted couples or groups that we were gazing at across the room or that were staying at the same motel with us. He'd invent whole histories for these people. Remembering that everybody has a story, I think, was the key to his always treating everybody with kindness and respect. I remember on countless occasions being out to dinner, and I often get grumbly about a clueless waiter or waitress who was keeping us waiting, and he would always stop and redirect me and comment patiently about the slow server. He said, somebody's a little boy, somebody's a little girl, he would say about this waiter, remind us all to be patient with them. And he was somebody's little boy, too, and that lively interest in other people and that kind-hearted respect for them came from his parents, I think. He loved his parents very much. He talked all the time about his childhood, quoted his father with special frequency, almost as much as I quote mine. Speaking of his parents, I have to tell a quick story here about Peltason Drive. He really was delighted by that. We all love driving on Peltason Drive. A whole city full of people who know how to spell and pronounce our name. It's wonderful. Anyway, he told me that the first time he came to the intersection where West Peltason completes its loop and meets East Peltason, so you have a W Peltason and an E Peltason, that all he could think of was his parents' names were Walter and Emma. And he said, so he thought it was just there for them always. And he loved that. He learned more than just kindness from his parents. I think there was also that sense of judgment, which came from the sense of perspective. If seeing beyond himself made him generous, it also made him wise. And he didn't just see beyond himself, he saw beyond the moment. Remember, he told me once that the hardest thing about being a university chancellor or president was helping other people in the community to remember in bad times that good times will come, and to remember in good times that bad times will come. It was one of those many moments where his ad libs just came out and emerged as aphorisms, memorable, widely useful, deeply true. I've had a lot of occasions to repeat that remark myself. And going along with that sense of perspective, emerging from it, strengthening it, was his sense of judgment, the calm and clear-eyed instinct to see the right thing and the strength of character to do it. He was never showy about doing the right thing. There was a complete lack of dramatic self-presentation. When he talked to me about difficult decisions or the handling of sensitive issues, he was never preachy or boastful about it. He just described matter-of-factly the obvious requirements of grown-up behavior, the way you would never let your own bad mood or hurt feelings affect a decision, the unthinkability of using your position to settle a score. But it was really unthinkable, not presented as a choice or a matter of moral heroism, but just as part of being a grown-up. And he was always a grown-up. Through all the years of our relationship, my childhood and adulthood, I can never remember a moment where I thought he was behaving unjustly to me or to anybody else, responding from pique or defensiveness. That's true of my mother, too. The two of them together have served me and my sisters all of our lives as models of adult conduct, of how to parent, of how to live. And speaking of my mother, I do have to acknowledge one small shortcoming of my father's. When it came to feminism and the divisions of household labor, he was not an early adopter. When it came to the division of household labor, he was never an adopter at all, it has to be said. But outside the home, same thing, he was too fair-minded a person not to see the plain justice of feminism when it was pointed out to him, too clear-eyed and fundamentally unprejudiced not to come rapidly and enthusiastically and all the way around when it came to his professional judgment. And really, whatever his retrograde attitudes to diaper changing or laundry doing, in a deep and important way, he was ready for feminism all along, because there was never around our house a trace of alpha male overbearingness in his behavior. He was never a mansplainer, never a testosterone-proud disciplinarian or deliverer of opinions. In addition to adoring my mother, he always, as any sensible person would, recognized the truly exceptional strength and quickness of her mind, the sharpness of her wit, the clarity of her vision, the soundness of her judgment. No child growing up in our household would ever have thought for a moment that his opinion mattered more than hers, and he didn't think so either. I do have to say a few words about the end of his life, about the bad times that did come to him after all the decades of wonderful good fortune and of success and happiness of every kind. Parkinson's disease was cruel to him, taking his mobility and his independence, and then taking from him and from all of us his ability to speak intelligibly. So much was lost when he couldn't speak easily, so much about the character of his wit, the ease, and the speed of it. He was brave and patient about that for so long. He always remembered and insisted that he'd been lucky to have such late onset of the Parkinson's, always expressed his good fortune that he was not in chronic pain, always took pains to stipulate that in spite of the Parkinson's disease, life had treated him well, that life had treated him well, that no reasonable person could find it unfair that he was struggling with a difficult health issue as he approached the end of his ninth decade and entered his 10th. But it really wasn't fair, and sometimes he did feel that. Sometimes he did, after a long struggle to speak, just look at me bleakly and say, "It's hard." But still, he was himself. Wonderful stories and wonderfully characteristic moments right up to the end. Remember, a couple of years ago, he confided almost mischievously in me about the difficulty of responding when people would say to him sympathetically, "It's just a tragedy, you can't speak any longer," when your mind is just as sharp as ever. And then he'd look at me with kind of an amused and sly smile and say, "It's not." And on another occasion, he worked long and hard to describe to me what he had lost when he lost the ability to speak easily, and telling me, and it was so obviously true, but I'd never thought about it in these terms before, telling me that when he couldn't speak fluently, it affected his ability to think fluently. "You don't compose your sentences before you speak them," he explained. "You think them as you speak them, and when you can't speak, you've lost so much." It was a striking conversation. He had to work so hard to get it out. But it was so true and insightful what he was saying to me, and this wasn't a matter of expertise or of learning, just of wonderfully intelligent observation of things as they are, explaining to me what he'd lost, but even as he did so, showing me how very much remained. Last anecdote, illustrating the persistence to the end of so many of his characteristic ways, of his self-awareness and his sense of humor. He was always worried when grandchildren, or in latter years, great-grandchildren were visiting, about the medications that were around the house. There were pills around, and also and especially about the indoor current pool that kids could get to through several different doors. And the rest of us were a little worried about the reckless way in which he navigated the house in his power wheelchair, backing up suddenly, herring off in one direction or another. You had to watch your toes very carefully, and it was awful to think about what the chair might do to a crawling toddler. We didn't want to hurt his feelings or limit his mobility or add to his anxieties by talking too much about the worry about his wheelchair, but it turned out that he understood the situation completely, and he pulled my daughter Jody aside when she was visiting not too long ago with my grandchildren, Rosie and Sam, his great-grandchildren, for a bit of pithy advice. He said, "When you're in this house, Jody," he said, "you have to be constantly on guard against the three P's." And when Jody asked what the three P's were, he told her, "Pools, pill, and Peltason." And ever after that, he'd catch her eye regularly and hold up three fingers to remind her of the three P's that she should be watching out for. Well, there's no more wheelchair bombing around the house now. It seems right that we hold the celebration of life when a ninth great-grandchild, Olivia Grace Redding, has just been born. And there are rumors of a tenth. I know what he would have said about the birth of a new great-grandchild, what he always said, "Uh-oh, another illiterate in the family." Because he knew that life is a series of unfinished projects. There's always something to worry about, always something to work on. I remember him telling me one time, "Don't wait to be happy until the inbox is empty. That never happens." And he knew that whenever you leave, you always have to leave in the middle. He adored children, and it's awful to think of these new great-grandchildren who will only have two of the three P's to worry about, who will grow up without knowing him and in a world without him. But of course, it won't be a world without him because we'll keep telling these stories. So I want to thank all of you so much for being part of his story, for your patience in listening to his story today, and for continuing to tell it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. That was beautiful. Must have been extremely difficult. Thank you. The formal part of the program is now over. Please, before we leave, join me in thanking the wonderful staff who have organized this event. I'd appreciate it if they would stand. Let me call them. Jesse Stewart. Amanda Sivsgal. Catherine Farish, Rachel Holland, Kelly Carland, Lindy Grishkoff, and Associate Chancellor Michael R. Arias. The reception is next door over here through the curtains to the left. Please join the Peltason family there. And also while you're there, please sign in the Book of Remembrance. Thank you so much for coming. Thanks everyone for your remarks. And Jack, thank you for all that you've done for us.